Hello and welcome to round one coverage of GP Seattle Tacoma. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Hall of Famer William Huey Jensen, and we're just about ready. We've got round one action, which means, Huey, we get to pick up a few players that we don't often get to see, like Cedric Phillips here, one of the top commentators in Magic, works a lot of weekends and does not have the opportunity to play in a lot of high-level events, but make no mistake, he is a high-level player. And he came down to a local GP for him. Cedric lives here in Seattle currently, and he's ready to roll. Now, Cedric is on Reanimator. His opponent, what's his first name? Robert Brews. I've been calling him the Bruiser.
Oh, yeah.
He's on Stax, and it's not quite what you'd expect. Now, Huey, I want you to talk us through what a Stax deck is attempting to do and what this Stax deck is attempting to do.
I think normally they're built to use, like, artifact mana denial. Mana denial so much as, like, cards that make their opponent's spells cost more to cast. They want to just lock them out of the game with Wastelands and Lodestone Golems and Thorns of Amethysts and Spheres of Resistance and Trinispheres. But this deck is a bit different. This deck has Trinisphere, but it also has cards like...
Go ahead.
Smokestack and Armageddon.
I want you to take a look here, Huey, at what the Bruiser is working with as he's getting Thought Seized. So, Smokestack's Armageddon to deny mana from his opponent. Is that a Tabernacle
That's
there,
That's a Tabernacle.
Goodness
he's playing six. One Tabernacle, but he also has the Crucible, which I expect... This is actually pretty tough. Crucible Chalice on one is really good against the deck that's playing Underground Sea Thoughtseize.
And he certainly has that available to him if Cedric doesn't take the Chalice here. Right,
but if he does take the Chalice, he gets to do something crazy like Mox Diamond, discard City of Traders, Mox Diamond, discard Tabernacle, Island, play Crucible.
Play
and
then, Crucible,
right,
go.
And then go. Yeah.
And then he's just got tons of mana for the next turn.
But he doesn't have a lot of action. Cedric is not really under any pressure. And so he takes the Chalice for that reason. This way, like, none of those cards are particularly threatening. I mean, Tabernacle's annoying, but okay, I'll pay one for my Gristlebrand. I'll pay one for my Iona. Who cares?
Okay. All right, so passes the turn back to the Bruiser. Robert Brews is going to kick things off with a Mox Diamond. He has no interest in that Tabernacle currently. And... yeah, Mox Diamond, City of Traders. Whoa, that's a lot of mana. And there's that Crucible. So just as you wrote it up, Huey, he fires it up. And I mean, like you said, he doesn't have a lot of action going. But next turn, you know, he could be one draw step away from playing a Planeswalker.
So interesting he chose to put City of Traders into play with Crucible.
Yeah.
Next turn, when he plays another land, he's going to have to sacrifice it. But he also didn't want to get his Crucible dazed. Like, just lose his whole hand to a daze, I think. Which I think is reasonable. Like, we know Cedric's playing Reanimator. He doesn't even know what Cedric's playing.
So he didn't want to get his Mox Diamond dazed?
No, he didn't want to get the Crucible dazed.
Oh, it's Crucible dazed.
If he were to discard the city and just play Islands,
gotcha.
He could start developing, getting more and more mana into play.
Uh-oh, what do we have here?
Cat's out of the bag.
Yeah, so at this point, Robert is going to know fully. He probably had a good idea of what Cedric might be up to, but, you know, turn one underground, see Thoughtseize. Doesn't have to be Reanimator. It's just on the short list. But now he knows.
Now he knows.
So we've got Ella Schnorn and a Show and Tell hitting the bin off of Careful Study. That's a ghostly prison there from Robert.
That is a ghostly prison, which actually is pretty annoying for Cedric. Given that his one threat is Ella Schnorn, like, he doesn't want to have to reanimate an Ella Schnorn and pay two to attack five times. With the Tabernacle in the graveyard then come into play, he's going to cost all his mana every turn just to do five damage. It's really slow. He really needs to find something like a Gristlebrand or an Inkwell Leviathan or something like that.
And you see Cedric kind of going over his options here. He had a Polluted Delta. And yeah, he's in the tank pretty hard here. Now, how good is Robert Brew's deck at dealing with a threat that does hit the table? Like, let's say Cedric does manage to hit something. Oh, it looks like... Cedric decided to Force of Will the Ghostly Prison there.
Well, I think it's such that Cedric might have, like, an Exhumed that he knows is going to get Elishnorn back.
Okay.
And he's thinking, well, I only have two lands. I can't beat this Tabernacle and Ghostly Prison. My hand doesn't really do anything else. If I draw a Gristlebrand, I have no way to discard it. So I'm just going to throw this Elishnorn into play, pay one a turn, and hope I get to attack four times. Because he knows that He knows that Brews is out of gas, the Bruiser.
Five times, right?
It's a 4.7 or 5.7? Five times, mistake.
So even more. Now, is the Bruiser going to be able to take advantage, though, of that time?
Well, that's the question. I mean,
like Jace the Mind Sculptor, bounce your guy?
Well, that's really good.
Yeah. I'm thinking that might be good.
Armageddon, then play Tabernacle from the Graveyard.
Ah, yeah. Wow, this is a sweet matchup. Looks like Cedric's talking to him a little here as he's playing Entomb and trying to decide what he wants to get. What if he does get Grizzlebrand into play, though?
Then it's
that's a different game.
That's a different game. Then if he's able to exhume it, for example, he goes for Leviathan.
Leviathan has Shroud, but the stuff that Robert's doing doesn't really care about Shroud that much outside of being able to bounce it, right?
I'm actually pretty surprised that Cedric would choose Leviathan here.
Interesting.
Over Grizzlebrand. Drawing 14 cards is just...
Yeah, it feels like it gives you a decided advantage. All right, well, let's see what Cedric's plan is here. Maybe things will become more clear. You don't really know what's in his hand.
It's also true that Cedric commentates a lot of Legacy, and he might think that Robert is playing a different kind of deck. Like, it might be similar to another deck he's seen. Like, we've seen the deck list, but all Cedric's seen is some Mox Diamonds and a few lands.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
That's a really good point. Oh, no. Here's a Wasteland to take down the Underground Sea, and you can see that Cedric has... permatap that swamp just to pay for Tabernacle repeatedly. And crunch. This is a really nice clock, though.
It is. The basic swamp doing work.
Yeah. Cedric does not want to forget to play for Tabernacle. And this is it. Robert has to do something immediately. Does he have an answer?
Oh, a prison.
Oh, and it was Force of Will in hand, though. And the game one handshake from Bruiser.
You know, that was a tight one.
Whew. All right, so that's going to do it for game one. That one goes to Cedric Phillips. As he was able to leverage that super quick clock, he must have had a Force of Will already in his hand and felt like, you know, he could keep at least one, you know.
Yep.
Potential spell at bay there to keep that clock up. It's only three turns, and the game is over.
Cedric looking to the sky to decide what to do with the sideboard.
It's early in the morning.
I'm taking a look at his list. I'm guessing he's probably still not 100% sure what's going on the other side.
Yeah.
Like, he's seen the ghostly prisons. I expect he has these abrupt decays to bring in. I expect they'll come in.
Okay.
Which is unfortunate for Robert, because his best card is almost definitely Ensnaring Bridge.
Oh.
When that card gets in play, it's very hard for these Show and Tell or Reanimator decks to ever do anything.
You know, it isn't. Yeah, that because our creatures are just massive, right? Yeah, okay.
So he has one in the main deck, but two more in the sideboard. Plus he has Academy Ruins. If Cedric's able to counter them, he can recur them and whatnot. Graft Digger's Cage.
Oh, yeah.
He has a lot of hate here.
Wow, yeah. He's going to be able to bring in some big guns. Now, you said that Cedric's got Abrupt Decay. What else does he have to try to interact here?
He could bring in three Jace Friend's Prodigy to attack on a different axis. It also is good against decks that don't appear like they can kill it. If I were Cedric, I would go like, oh, this Jace is definitely coming in. My opponent has Ghostly Prison in his deck. He's not going to bolt my Jace and play a Ghostly Prison. The cards just don't go well together. Like, if your answer to creatures is to stop them from attacking you, you're not also going to have a ton of creature removal.
Wow, Jace Friend's Prodigy is in this list?
Yeah.
That card, man.
Well, it's great. It loots, right?
Yeah.
You're like, loot, discard a Gristlebrand, reanimate it. And they counter it, and then you're like, flashback, reanimate, do it again.
It's so brutal.
Yeah.
Looks like he's considering Show and Tells here. All right, let's take a live look in while our players are getting sideboarded at what Carlos Romão's doing over there against Seo Dwan. Carlos is on the right.
Carlos is on Infect, it looks like.
Ah.
And Sayo is on Storm, maybe? Who knows?
Yeah, he's got a couple of Brainstorms. He's got a Ponder and some lands. Yeah, it is hard to say.
It is Storm.
It is Storm.
I have the list here.
Okay.
This is just like a Goldfish matchup. Storm player starts at 10 life.
All right. Well, how about some therapy? How are you feeling, Carlos? How was your week? Whoa, he's got a stacked up hand. And whatever Seo named, he hit. I can't see
will.
It. It was force.
The,
okay. Quest,
the interesting thing is, depending on what Carlos cast that turn, he has no blue mana.
Ah, right. If we're assuming he cast that Noble Hierarch here.
Right. Which he probably didn't, actually, because he would have attacked with Glistener Elf if that wasn't what he cast that turn.
All right, so Seo hits.
Seo seems to be advantaged here.
Yeah,
Carlos can only cast one spell a turn, and he had no pump. Like, he's going to have to attack three or four times with this.
Right.
With this this Glistener Elf. And yeah. Even his disruption, it's like, it's good disruption. The spell pierce in the days, he had a force will, but now that the spell pierce in the days are known, they're much less effective.
So much
the conditional
less, yeah.
counters are very ineffective when they're known to your opponent.
Now he is resolving a brainstorm here on end step, which could certainly help him find some of those explosive pump spells, right?
Yeah, it's not the best brainstorm when you have to do it on end step. You put two back, then you draw one anyway. It doesn't get you that much deeper in your deck, although because he's so bottlenecked on blue mana, he had to do it now. He couldn't risk waiting.
He does
brainstorming
have a
main phase. If he just misses on another blue or a fetch, he's just like locked out almost.
Right. Now he found a Misty Rainforest here, so he is going to be able to do some manipulation, whether it's shuffling away that last card if he doesn't want it, or maybe setting up another brainstorm or whatever.
Looks pretty good. He can play a second Hierarch. He can Pendlehaven his Glistener Elf and
so
deal
four
poison.
Wow.
So any pump next turn, aside from a third Hierarch, will be lethal, assuming that Seo has no way to interact.
Okay.
He was able to keep the Spell Pierce and Daze and can now play both because of the Misty.
So he's trying to decide how he wants to sequence this out. Looks like he's going to kick things off with Pendlehaven, which he has to do to make sure that he can...
He's probably thinking to himself, do I need to use Pendlehaven? Is there any scenario where it increases my clock by a turn?
Ah.
Like, if somehow... This is very uncommon, but Carlos is astute enough to think about it for sure. Like, if Seo boarded in Dazes or Spell Pierces of his own, do I gain anything from this Pendlehaven? I guess he thought ultimately he did, but I can see the argument that you don't. If
okay.
you need a pump spell to win in two turns anyway, otherwise it's going to be three regardless. At least that's a consideration.
Yeah, and so that's what he's thinking about. Brainstorm before anything happens, though, from Seo, who's really just trying to set up his big turn here.
Right.
He's got to be moving toward in that direction. I already saw a Lion's Eye Diamond in his deck. He's going to duress now. And yeah, that was the first blood for the poison there. You can see in the upper right hand of your screen that our main match is still just getting underway as far as resolving mulligans and such. And once they're ready, we'll jump back up there, but we'll stick here until...
I'm curious. I think if I'm Carlos, I might just go ahead and Spell Pierce this duress.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So what's the thinking there? It taps him out.
Well, if you let it resolve and he sees that the card you added to your hand from the brainstorm doesn't do anything, which I think it's just like a Blighted Agent. I think it's a third card in Carlos's hand. Then if Seo's hand is good enough to kill you, he's going to kill you. So you're going to have to draw your
your Carlos likes your play there. He did the same thing. Even though Dwan can pay for it.
Yeah, but he knows what's going to. Like he understands.
He does have a ponder here as well. I mean, what's the kind of card that Carlos is going to be worried about from Seo's perspective?
Well, it's not so much a card. He's just worried about losing the game right now.
He just doesn't want to get stormed off.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
It'll be like, you know, Ritual, Lion's Eye Diamond, Infernal Tutor, Sack the Lion's Eye Diamond, get Burning Wish, whatever this list has.
Whatever you'd like to finish.
Yeah, however you want to win from that point.
All right, looks like our main match is going, so why don't we jump back there. Cedric Phillips up a game.
Wow, did Brews play a turn one, turn two Trinisphere?
Oh, he sure did. Yeah, Ancient Tomb powers that out. Now, what is that going to do to Cedric's game plan here?
This is really tough for Cedric. Cedric's playing a 19 land deck. And part of the reason you're able to do that is because you have four Brainstorm, four Careful Study, four Ponder. And guess what? Those all cost three mana now. So you have to naturally draw a sixth of the land in your deck in order to even cast your cantrips.
So
your Lotus Petals cost three mana.
Yeah. That's miserable. So Cedric is responding with Entomb here. Trinisphere on the stack.
I could see Cedric deciding Ashen Rider out of the sideboard is worth putting in his graveyard here. Always I could see Gristlebrand.
Old Inky is what he goes for.
Well, it worked last time.
It did. Now, getting it into play is going to be a lot harder this time with that Trinisphere hanging around.
Two basic lands for Cedric, which
is... he's not fussing around with that whole Crucible Wasteland thing.
He only has two basic lands in his deck.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so...
so an Armageddon?
Yeah, it's like this Wasteland is, like, backbreaking. Cedric has to play a third land, gets to cast one spell off it, loses the land.
Wow. So we're seeing the Stax deck really employ its strategy of mana denial here in a big way against Cedric, who's going to have to manage every land drop he finds. Like you said, he's only got 19 in the deck. So...
yeah.
The number of spells he actually gets to cast is going to be really limited this game. The question is just if Robert can capitalize on it, start getting some pressure. You know, any Planeswalker, anything really could do a lot of work here. Is that a Magus of the Tabernacle
there? That is a Magus of the Tabernacle.
Okay. So now anything that Cedric gets is going to be even tougher to keep. Passes a turn back.
Now, it's interesting. Cedric didn't play a third land, but it's quite possible he chose not to play a third land because of the Wasteland, because he doesn't have a spell he wants to spend that on. And he'll have to, you know, wait and find a fourth land or a card like Reanimate, so his third land actually matters, rather than just using it to cast something like Ponder. This lock is getting pretty hard over there.
This is getting real tough here, yeah. In the meantime, the clock is on. The 2/6 Magus of the Tabernacle. Well, it will get the job done eventually. Like if Cedric just can't cast spells or can only cast one or two for the rest of the game, it's going to get the job done. I don't know that it's his primary win condition, but...
well, if you think about it, this game is really, really tough for Cedric, right? Like, given that we know he has two basic lands in his deck... he's going to have to pay one to keep his creature in play and two every time he attacks and get around Wasteland Chalice. That means he has to basically play a land.
Wasteland Crucible, yeah.
He has to play a land and use it just every time he attacks just to attack. So it's like discard a land from hand to be able to attack with one creature. That's tough.
And, you know, we talked earlier that that Robert's got two copies of Armageddon in his deck as
well. There are a lot of cards that I think for Robert here effectively end the game on the spot. Like, I think looking at Cedric's list... well, there's Abrupt Decay, I suppose. But I think, you know, if Cedric's play is just like reanimate, even with the Leviathan in play, I think another Ghostly Prison, an Ensnaring Bridge, a lot of these cards almost end the game on the spot.
What does Cedric Abrupt Decay here if he found one?
Well, it depends on his hand.
Okay, because, I mean, he's got multiple problematic permanents that he's got to deal with.
That's for sure. My guess would be you'd have to start with the Trinisphere.
Okay.
And then start chaining cantrips to find answers to the rest of the stuff.
All right, here we go. This is show and tell, and there's an Ashen Rider. A smokestack, though, from Robert. And you got a little, man, really? Yeah, this is just all business here for the Bruiser.
So my guess, this is tough.
So Ashen Rider trigger is going to go on the stack here, and Cedric gets to exile a permanent. And I think he's going to go ask a judge for a Oracle text or something. Yeah,
could be any interaction between these cards. I could see an argument for practically all of Robert's permanents. Like, I wouldn't exile the Magus.
Found one.
I probably wouldn't exile the smokestack. I'd probably resign myself to the fact my Ashen Rider is going to die next turn. to the smokestack, and I'll get it then.
Okay.
I'm guessing the hand that I think Cedric has to have for him to win the game, I haven't seen Cedric's hand, but a handful of cantrips is what Cedric, I think, needs to have to sort of go forward.
Okay, so that's why you were saying spells. The Trinisphere would
so
be...
So I think the Trinisphere, and okay. Then you can do something like put Gristlebrand in play, draw a bunch of cards, and try to find Abrupt Decay to remove the other stuff or something like that.
Okay.
As long as Trinisphere's in play and you can only cast one spell a turn, it's really tough.
All right, Cedric's back after consulting with the judge.
Yeah.
And yeah, it looks like Cedric agrees. Exile that Trinisphere. And that could open the door for Cedric to get back in this, but it is going to be difficult. We see that... Robert's got the Wasteland, and oh, he's going to pay for his own Magus with that. Wow, I thought he was going to take out the Underground Sea there, but it looks like he doesn't.
Yeah, that's very surprising.
Maybe a little bit of an opening here for Cedric if he actually gets to keep this Underground Sea for a turn.
Unless he's just casting Armageddon or something.
Yeah, that could be. Or maybe he has another Wasteland or something.
Yeah, that could be too.
Whoa. I mean, I guess it is a free attack because it's a 2-6 versus a 5-5.
Looking at the list to see if there's a Cataclysm or something.
Okay.
But there's not.
Oh, double smokestack? Does this resolve? I know there's a Force of Will in hand for Cedric, so he has the option. But he also needs all the resources he can get right now. So what does this second smokestack do here, Huey? I don't think I've ever actually had a board with double smokestack. Well, it does enough for Cedric to counter it.
It protects the first one. Well, it doesn't protect it necessarily, but it just gives you a redundant smokestack so he can't Ashen Rider the first one.
Gotcha.
It also just makes everything much faster.
So we're talking, Cedric's clarifying which triggers are going on when here.
He just wants to
triggers.
Make sure that he can sacrifice the Ashen Rider to smokestack before he has to pay for it.
Right. And he does. So now Ashen Rider dies. There's another trigger. He gets to exile a permanent. Does he just have to take out the smokestack?
No. Depends on his hand.
Okay.
If his hand is full of reanimate cards, I guess it doesn't matter. At some point in this turn, he's going to want to take out the smokestack. So I think he wants to do it now just to be safe in case, Robert starts Force of Willing spells or who knows what.
Sure, something weird happens. Now remember, the Trinisphere is gone and Cedric now has the ability to kind of do what he wants. Like, he's not under any real constraints here. All right, now it looks like we're back to upkeep and figuring out how these stacks, how the stack went, but looks like they've got it sorted.
Never hurts to clarify.
Yeah, he's at 15 life, and he does have Reanimate in his hand, Cedric Phillips.
And Exhume, I think.
So he can get that Ashen Rider back again and start kind of chewing up the board. Cedric's going to go for a Ponder here.
He also has a Lotus Petal, so he can put both his creatures into play.
Ooh, there's another Exhume off of the Ponder. And a Grizzlebrand.
Oh, yeah?
Hello.
Does he have a way to discard it, though?
That is the question.
I think Cedric's turn here might just be put Ashen Rider and Inkwell Leviathan into play, remove your Ghostly Prison, go.
Is that a good turn?
Yeah, sounds okay.
All right, he looks like he's decided to shuffle.
Yeah.
He's already got good threats in the graveyard and a reanimation spell, and he can cast both this turn with that Lotus Petal. I like that line.
Or if he draws a land, he doesn't even need to use the petal.
Hmm.
Although...
Suppose he just gets it on the battlefield anyway.
Yeah. It's actually interesting. I guess the land is just like a petal later. I was thinking if you wanted to hold the land in case there was another weird Trinisphere interaction, but the petal does the same thing, except it can never be wastelanded.
Right. Or Armageddon. So here it is. Exhume, bringing back Ashen Rider. Another trigger. This Ashen Rider has laid waste to Robert Brew's battlefield here. This is going to be the third thing that it's exiling. And another thing I want to note here, Huey, He's at 8.
Yeah.
Robert has tapped those ancient tombs a bunch of times and brought himself down to 8 life here. And he is content to just keep using that wasteland. He wants to keep the colored mana available and doesn't want to tap those tombs anymore. He's become very conscious of it. But he's really let Cedric have some wiggle room here by not taking out that underground sea last turn. Here's the City of Traders. Robert, sticking to the
attack.
Plan.
It's
yeah,
a free attack. I like it.
I like it too.
I respect it.
Cedric's going to use the underground sea to pay for the rider. And Cedric's just going to get in there for 5.
Yeah, I mean, it's like a stone rain almost. Stone rain one of your ancient tombs with
yeah.
the attack from the Ashen Rider.
Here's Ponder Shuffle. No, Ponder
he's
going to
keep the Abrupt Decay.
Ah.
It's a good answer to anything that he doesn't need it right now, but it's a good answer to all of the problems that he's seen that could come up.
Yeah, Cedric looks like he's in fantastic shape
here. Agree. Even Armageddon doesn't do anything. He can pay for the Magus with the pedal.
Oh, sweet. Cedric thinking through the last little details. He knows he's in a winning position here. He just wants to make sure he doesn't do something to screw it up. And he looks like he's going to reanimate something here.
And Gwilleviathan, he's at least thinking about it.
His life totals of no concern. So even though he takes a bunch of damage, what is it, 9 by doing this? But shrug. Doesn't really matter. Robert, we're in his upkeep here.
Robert's thinking about what to do if he should pay for the Magus.
I mean, does he have any way out of this?
Yeah. Ensnaring. Well, from his perspective, Ensnaring Bridge.
Okay.
We know Cedric has a Abrupt Decay, but...
Can also give you an update that Dwan, the Storm player, playing against Carlos Romau, he did win game 1. And that is going to be our match here as Robert Brews cannot find an answer to the massive beasts that that Cedric Phillips reanimated. And Cedric is going to be 1-0 to start GPC
yeah.
TAC. So
those
nice
were not
work
small
for
creatures.
We're not. And those Ashen Riders seem to be a major issue, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because in many ways, Robert's deck gives you the opportunity to sack yeah. it, right? You're like, I'm not going to pay for Magus, kill that thing that was
right.
a big issue
right.
for me. As it turned out, Cedric preferred to just kill Robert.
Right.